My guests today are writer-producer Michael Bickel and producer Todd Feldman. Now, writer-producer Michael Bickel's new animated short film, Nate and John, is more than just a story. It's a labor of love that has consumed his creative spirit for the past 15 years. So with Nate and John, Michael aims to touch the hearts of audiences worldwide, offering a poignant reminder of the power of human connection and the enduring strength of the human spirit. Now, producer Todd Feldman has a successful entrepreneur across multiple industries. Now, through his management and production company, the Feldman Company, Todd has produced films and packaged and set several television shows at various broadcast and streaming outlets. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome writer-producer Michael Bickel and producer Todd Feldman and their animated short film, Nate and John, to the show. Welcome, gentlemen.
Pleasure to be here.
Thanks.
You're very welcome. Now, Michael, now this animated short film is wonderful. So much to unpack here. Why did it take 15 years to bring this masterpiece to life?
Well, how much time do we have? You know, I've always been a creative person, but never really had the ability or the facility to make things happen, right? We're in a business in Hollywood where you need 100 yeses to get something made. And, you know, I've known Todd for over 20 years. And it's a difficult process. And I've had this idea about human connection and the relationship between the customer and the barber and how that relationship is over time. I guess we'll talk about it. But, you know, they reached a point, I think Todd could jump in too, during COVID is really took off for us.
Wow. I just want to add that obviously the beginning of COVID was very scary and isolating for a lot of folks. And Mike and I, as Mike said, we've known each other for 20 plus years. As a matter of fact, I met Mike because he won a prominent screenwriting competition, and I ended up signing him. And when COVID hit, we really sort of regrouped and said, okay, we're all sort of sitting here alone. How can we come together? How can we unite? And we brushed off this idea that Mike had started 15 years earlier.
Well, is Nate and John based on a personal experience?
You know, I think it's an experience we all have. That's what makes this kind of a special project. And that's the reason why it's touching so many people is we all have these interactions, you know, on a daily basis. We walk into the drugstore and we have this good morning, how are you conversation with the customer and the barber. It's a little bit more elaborate. You know, you sit there, we all have it. You go for the every 6 weeks, every 8 weeks to the barber. There's no phones, which is a big deal nowadays, right? And you have to have this connection, this interaction. And, you know, in my case, and I think everybody who's, you know, seen the movie kind of relates to it, you open up very quickly. You know, we all have this guarded life that we protect ourselves. But then when the opportunity comes to talk to basically a total stranger, we're all open. We're all want to have this connection. And that's the origin. I just found myself having these conversations with my barber, you know, every 6 weeks. And it's deep conversation for that 15 minutes. And I just thought it was a special relationship that I hadn't seen on film.
This has to be not only one of my favorite animated short films, this is one of my favorite overall short films in general, because you touch on the human connection, you touch on the human spirit. And there's, for a short film that is just what, barely 7 minutes long?
Correct. Yeah.
You created a film that has so much in it. I almost felt like I watched a full feature. That's how big and wonderful this masterpiece is. And I'm going to call it a masterpiece because it truly is. And what a film that both of you should be extremely proud of. Now, break down the characters for me. Who is Nate and who is John?
I'll let Todd jump on that, but I just do want to jump onto your point, and no dialogue for the 7 minutes.
That's right. And I'm glad you brought that up, because here's where your film becomes magical. And because it's animated, you know, we can look back at many animations. I mean, we can look at Tom and Jerry, and that's really a in a way where there's really no dialogue. It's the music score. It's how certain sounds are placed to evoke emotion and response to what's going on screen. And I love films that have no dialogue, but what I love even more here is that because your film has no dialogue, most people who watch this film will never notice that. And that is the power that this film has. So Todd, go ahead and tell us who Nate and John is.
I appreciate Mike deferring to the producer to explain the characters he created, but Mike will color this a little bit. But John, we'll start with John. I mean, John is, as Mike said, John is all of us. John is just somebody who spends, a couple of a half hour once a month going to what I like to call solitude, just sitting there and just, as Mike said, phones turned off. John is everybody. And Nate, again, represents, again, Mike, you can pick this up, but Nate, to me, represents somebody who is passionate, hardworking, proud. I think pride is a and Mike again spoke so eloquently that we all have these relationships. It's not just a barber client. It's a teacher, student. It's just somebody that has affected our lives, oftentimes not even realizing it.
When it came to writing this short film, and I know that it has, you know, when you start working on an animation, there's so much work to do. I mean, far more than doing a live action short. You know, live action shorts can be filmed within 2 to 5 days. Editing is up to anywhere from 2 weeks to 6 months. But animation, that is a long, drawn-out process. So, Michael, walk us through, in a way, beginning to end of writing this actual story and then creating and working with animators to tell an absolute complete story in 7 minutes.
Yeah. So, first off, it's a great opportunity for us to bring up our director, Jumai Youssef, and our producer, Gene Liu. Without them, this doesn't happen, you know. So the script that I wrote was, you know, over a period of time, putting it together, and I wasn't quite sure if it was going to be animation or live action. I didn't know where this fell. And we got connected with Jumai and Gene, and they were able to say, hey, look, we see animation and we see a way to put this into, you know, without dialogue, into a story and make it all seamless. And they brought in an amazing composer, which, as you mentioned, music plays a big part of this as well. And, you know, we started the process first time for all of us, and the actual artists who did a lot of them were first time graduates from USC. So we all kind of started this journey, as Todd said, during COVID. You know, people from around the world, different genders. That's why the name of our production company is Unity Animation Project. We brought all these people together. We had these group meetings and, you know, naively, we thought, okay, 6 months, you know, we'll have something. It was probably closer to 2 years. You know, it is a slow process. You know, our meetings were looking at frame by frame and this look and that look and what can we do for this amount of dollars, because that's also a limitation, and trying to, you know, everybody coming together, it was a labor of love. We all wanted to tell this story, to have that final moment where everyone kind of feels that heartwarming, you know, reaction, which is, I think, what we got. So, yeah. So, you know, putting us all together, we took 2 years and we finally got through it. But the result that we're very proud of.
Yeah, I would be very, very proud of this work. And one of the magics that I see in this film is the way the story begins and ends, but frame by frame, scene by scene. And this is why I think that by going to animation works far better than live action, in this case with a story, because with animation, you're able to start morphing the timeline. You know, we see them younger, and then we see as things go by, you know, they start to get older. And I think that morphing by using animation adds to the story, helps the audience to follow the story that much more, because it allows us, because look, we today, more now than it was 20 years ago, we live in a very huge visual world. And so we have to capture an audience visually today, where 20, 30 years ago, as long as somebody picked up a magazine or a newspaper and actually read something, for them to actually get to the point or maybe read a book that evoked emotion, now it's all visual.
Yeah.
But you pulled off a visual storytelling masterpiece with Nate and John. So kudos to both of you. And I can imagine the 2 years on this. Now, let me ask you this about the animation. How did you choose the style of animation?
You know, Todd, you want to talk about that a bit?
Yeah, I thank you for asking that, because as Mike just alluded to, that was very, very deliberate. We wanted something, and I know this is going to sound a bit odd because it looks sort of, I don't want to say old, but evergreen. It is a, we did not want anything too sharp or slick or modern. We wanted to be able to tell the story almost as well through the animation. The actual look helps tell the story.
It does. Do you remember back in the day, the old Harvey tunes? Because a lot of the Harvey tunes were really like comical educational pieces, but the look was very classic. It's very flat, if you know what I mean. You know, it's like when you're looking at your film and you see John with his father walking down the sidewalk before they enter into the barbershop. Mm-hmm. It has that layered, flat look, which mm-hmm. I fell in love with because it reminded me of classic animation. And like you said, you didn't go the slick route. You didn't go the live action 3D type routes that everybody seems to be going to now. I love this look because I think it tells a story far better than just some slick animation job.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Michael.
Before we leave that point, I want to give Jumai, you know, the credit. She really led that look, and we certainly jumped on and said, "Oh, that you got it right. That's the look we're looking for." And I just in case, you know, probably most people have not seen the animation yet. It starts out in the 1960s with, and the two characters are basically 17 or 18 years old. That's when they first meet as a customer and the barber. And then it follows through the 7 minutes, as you said, all the way through till they're in their 60s. So it does go through eras, it goes through decades, it goes through, obviously, they get from teenagers to senior citizens. So it did take a lot of thought and effort to get that look right. And Jumai and Jean, you know, had played a big part in that.
Well, how did you come to meet Jumai?
You know, we were looking for, you know, again, the idea behind the Unity Animation project is to kind of work with people from around the world, you know, different genders, different religions, different viewpoints, because I feel like we're all the same. And we sometimes we forget that. And it's a disturbing thing to think that we are so divided in a lot of cases, right? So we just wanted to reach out beyond our usual circles, and we asked around, and, you know, we got names and we spoke to a few, you know, different people, and these two young ladies, you know, just knocked us out.
So, well, when it comes to animation, how many people did it take to bring this to life?
That's a great question. We should know that exact answer.
And I think it's between 80 and 100. I
if
think
you look at the crawl, right? The crawl, yes, it's an amazing amount of folks that, as Mike said, Mike might have said this. This was our first animated project, and it was in a great way mind blowing. Almost the entire process to understand what actually needs to get done to put something out there in the world. So we're really proud.
It's always amazing to me when you watch a short film and it seems simple, and then you watch the credits and they roll with all these names, right? And now I really understand what it is and why there's so many, and they deserve, I hope our credits are slow enough to slow down on everybody's name, because they all play such a big part in this. Yeah.
You know, the last animated short that I saw that I loved was the one that was Oscar nominated, 95 Senses. And your film evokes some of that emotion, but what I really love is that your film brings, I call it warm and fuzzy, but I will tell you this, warm and fuzzy brings more awards than any other type of film out there. And for both of you, I'm expecting this film to bring a lot of awards. But it's amazing how some of the most influential people in our lives are those that actually go unnoticed. You know, it could be like a barber, a teacher, a janitor, a waitress, or even the librarian. But they can make a huge impact on our lives. This short film, Nate and John, it makes us literally take a moment to realize that everyone makes a contribution to our lives. And I just love this film for helping all of us to remember those who have touched our lives. When I saw this film for the first time, it took me back. And one of my favorite school teachers, I still remember her, Mrs. Malasky, and she was Jewish. She loved her heritage, but she was always encouraging. And just to have those little moments in time that you can still think about years later, and that's what your film does to so many. What type of stories have both of you been receiving from those who have actually been able to see this film?
I'll say that because it's a U.S. premiere, it had to be sort of close vested up to date. But for those that have, I will say, Mike and I were very close to it, obviously, the entire process with the rest of the team. So it is really nice to hear your words and to hear the words and thoughts of others. I'm very moved. I think that's a lot of people find it very moving.
I think what, you just spoke about 30 seconds about your teacher, right? And I think that's the reaction. I just came from the festival, the American Pavilion at Cannes, and
the emerging film
show there. And there were 30 finalists, and we actually won the Cultural Impact Award, which was like shocking. We were so overwhelmed that we got this reaction. But as people came up afterwards, they started to tell me about their teacher, their neighbor, their dentist, their barber, and I think that was the goal. The goal, as you said, was exactly right, to remember that we're all in this together. We all have value to each other. We're all on the same journey. We could learn from everybody, and everybody can touch us, and we can touch others, not to shut down, right? So again, during COVID, we all kind of shut down, is don't give up, don't give up on your fellow human. That's really kind of the end all to this.
Yeah, there's a part in your film, which I just call it the unity scene. That's what I've kind of nicknamed it. You place the Martin Luther King news about his assassination in your film. Why was this important?
That's you, Mike.
Yeah, so, I don't know if we even touched on it, but John is Caucasian and Nate is African-American. And they meet in the 60s. And you can't have this begin in the 60s without some, reference to the era and what was happening during that time and the struggle that the African American community was going through. So it just only made sense that that moment is the pinnacle of pain that we need to bring into the film. And it was a lot, that was a heavy piece to think about, right? Because here we are, this animation, and, you know, I think, again, Jumai did a brilliant job in layering that in. It's the only time there really is sound, because there's a little clip of the news.
Yeah.
But, so it's not dialogue, but it's a clip of the news on the TV. But it was a moment to, you know, really understand early. Again, we only have 7 minutes to meet these two guys and to go on this journey. And it was a crucial moment, both politically and the environment, but also for the storytelling, that, you know, John, this young Caucasian, wanted to be with Nate during this moment, and sit with him and just support him. And it showed the beginning of this bond that will go on for another 50 years.
You know, it's, you bring up a poignant part of this. This film is non-dialogue, but by adding in that VO of the newscast, really drove that friendship closer. And it is that moment that really seals their friendship for life. And you couldn't have done that any better.
You know, it's one of those things where you I wrote it, you know, years earlier, and I wrote that out. But how does that translate to an animation? And again, Jumai, you know, a director, really found the right notes and the right look for that.
Well, you know, when the animation of the television and it's broadcasting, you couldn't have used a better animated outline of the photo that we've seen for years. We grew up seeing it. We saw it in school, of the people pointing in the direction as they were standing on the motel balcony. And as simple as that was, it was very, very powerful.
Yeah, you know, that if anybody who has seen that, or I've been to Memphis and gone to the museum, that motion is so embedded in my head that, you know, again, we're trying to tell a story really quickly, and that got us there really quick. And again, Jumai did a great job on doing that voiceover. I think it was even a friend of hers that did the newscast, sort of, because we couldn't get the original version. So, you know, it just became this magical moment that I think that's where it really jumps off and takes us on this fuller journey. Yeah,
it does. And I don't want to give too much away to those that are watching and listening, because I want everyone to have the opportunity. If they are attending Tribeca, you better be buying a ticket to watch this film. As the months go by, whenever the film is available, or maybe next year when the film is available for public viewing, I don't want to give anything away, but you have these little nuances in this film that if people pay attention to the 7 minutes, they're going to see things in the beginning that will show up towards the end. And it just ties this film just together. I mean, it's perfectly bookend, and those bookends are emotion. And it's really love and respect is what has come as the bookends on this film, Nate and John. So stellar, stellar work. But Todd, I've got a question for you. Yeah. So you have this company, the Feldman Company. Mm-hmm. What is the operation of your company when it comes to bringing on a film like Nate and John? What is your job?
Well, thank you for asking that question. So I'll just, without making the true distinction, I'll make the distinction that I started in the business as a producer back in the mid 90s. I made my first film, called Trash. It was called Nobody's Children. It's called Trash. So I made that. And then I became, because I was working with these just wonderful artists, writers, in particular, and directors, I started to think, well, I should, since I'm working with them, I should manage them. So I am a producer that also manages. And I don't want to, again, make too much of a distinction there, except that that matters to me. And so I just want to point out, because it's really, really important. And first of all, just thank you before this interview ends for this opportunity and for really getting it. You truly, it's so heartwarming to hear your thoughts on something Mike and I and the rest of the team really tried to convey. So thank you for that. And I just want to say that I try to work with artists, writers, and directors that have something to say and on the surface can be funny or sweet or scary, but really that also have social relevance. Almost everything Mike has ever written, ever, and he is a stellar writer and an even better person. Everything has some other message of hope, or it's like I said, it's socially relevant. So to answer your question, I tried to do things like that, and this was a no-brainer, certainly during COVID and wanting to bring people together.
You know, this is the type of film that I literally want millions of people to see. We live in a world today where we are culturally, racially divided. And this is a film that in a way can glue all that together. Because when I watch the film, I'm not looking at black or white. I'm looking at friendship. I'm seeing something that's extremely endearing. I'm seeing love. And it's, again, I'm a sucker for warm and fuzzy. And this film, oh my gosh, I place it at the top. And I can see why you've already become an award-winning film already. What was it like to be notified that you were going to be appearing at the Tribeca Film Festival?
A thrill. You know, I think I still remember Todd and I looking at the email and calling each other and like, you know, as you mentioned at the beginning, this is probably, you know, 15 years that I started writing the first, you know, outline, and then 2 years of all this work. And then, you know, as we said, to show it, to let it out to the public and hope. And what's one of the things that Todd brings to it too, as a producer and also creative talent, all the time we're going through it, I think Todd's main focus is that we hit those points that you mentioned, those heartwarming points. You know, sometimes it wasn't quite there. And, you know, sometimes I'll back off and say, okay, that's good enough. But Todd was like, no, we got to get that extra second, that extra beat, that extra moment. So, you know, besides everything else, that's another thing Todd brings to the table. But to find out we're at Tribeca, you know, I'm a New Yorker, unless you can tell from the accent, and to be in my hometown, and Todd and I are both going there to see it live on the 15th, we're beyond thrilled, of course. I think we were also part of, Todd, correct me, Whoopi Goldberg.
Curated a certain number of these short animations for this particular screening.
Fantastic. And Michael, I want to ask you this question. You have been working on Nate and John, let's say 15 years. What was your first emotion when you actually saw the first piece of this come to life?
Yeah. You know, it's a good question, and it's a hard, as much as I'm fancy myself a writer, it's hard to put that into words. You know, I've been at different forms of writing for quite a while, and to see it become something, I call it soup, right? You have these ingredients, but there's a moment when it becomes something beyond the ingredients. There's a soup. And then you try to season the soup and make the soup better. But, you know, somewhere along the line of those 2 years, we started getting little pieces come to us. And it's surreal. And it's, you know, people creatively say, well, it's like a child, like, you know, I have three children. So it's like, you get that same feeling, like all of a sudden this thing that was inside of you for so long is now in the real world, and you just want to kind of make sure everybody kind of gets a little taste and hopefully loves it. So it's great. It's great.
So what, for both of you, what was it like to sit down for the first time and see this film from beginning to end in its entirety and ready to go? What was your emotion and feeling when you saw the completed film?
I'll say as a creative producer, I consider myself a creative producer, and I'm just going to be blunt and honest, as of course we are going to be. The first time you watch it, as Mike said, you're it's hard to be objective, but at the same time, the pride is remarkable that we actually did this. I always say there are a lot of people, like, I'll just say this: there are so many great ideas out there, and if somebody asked me for advice, I'd say just truly try to execute. Do whatever you need to do to try to make these things happen, because you never ever know. This is a true testament. We thought we had something potentially fun and meaningful, but it's now taking on a little bit of a life of its own.
Yeah. The first time I saw it, you know, was on my phone. You know, when everyone's on the phone and you watch it, and you know, it's great. But you know, when I went to this festival in Cannes a couple of weeks ago, and we saw it, it was the first time I saw it with an audience. You know, there was 50, 60 people there. And it became a different thing, right? All of a sudden I hear laughter. I heard a sniffle or two at the end, you know, with some tears. And it becomes a different animal at that point. And, you know, in this particular festival, again, I referenced it before, there were 30 finalists, and there were some, not all animation. It was in fact mostly live action, and some big budgeted war movies with Bosnia and Germany. And like, we were not on the radar to win anything. And in fact, when they came up to give the award, I didn't have my phone on. Like, I was just watching to see, oh, somebody's going to win an award here. This is great. I wonder who's going to win. And they talked about it for a minute or two and saying about, you know, how this meant a lot to them, and the impact and friendship. And she said friendship. I'm like, oh, wait a minute. We have friendship in our animation. And then she said Nate and John. And I was shocked. So, you know, to see it live for the first time in an audience and then to win the award the same, it was crazy.
Man, both of you better get ready, because I think you're about to have a mantle full of awards. And this is a film, and I've seen a lot of film. This one has the elements of Oscar written on it. And because I'm just going to leave it there, because everybody in the world needs to see this film. Nate and John, this is a global animated film that I think that is, like I said, it is going to be, it has the power of super glue to bring all of us together and realize that this world, well, we need each other. And that's what this film is going to show. And boy, for both of you, man, if I were you, I'd be nervous and excited at the same time.
You got it. Those two things, you got it. Yeah.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you this. The animated short film Nate and John is a story of love, respect, and endearing friendship. Today, when you're out and about, take notice of those that you see on a regular basis. Be a blessing. Be an encourager to everyone you meet. Who knows? You may find a friend in the most unusual or common places. Now, Nate and John is one of the best, and I emphasize best, animated short films I've seen in the last couple of years. Now look, I've already said it before, I'm a sucker for warm and fuzzy, heartfelt films, because we need more of them in our lives and in front of our eyes. So I want to thank you, Michael and Todd, for sharing your film with us today.
Pleasure.
Well, you are welcome, gentlemen, and much, much success to both of you at the Tribeca Film Festival, as well as to all of the other film festivals to come. So get ready. Like I said, I think your mantle is about to be full.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
You're very welcome. And ladies and gentlemen, hey, you can catch all of the replays of our interviews with the top film directors and producers and screenwriters, as well as actors and more, on our YouTube channel and on our website, bondoncinema.com. We are available on a dozen audio platforms, so feel free to subscribe to either YouTube, iTunes, or Spotify. But I want to thank you for watching and listening. And as for me, I'm either going to see you at the movies or from the red carpet.